Alchemy. And this is the author, Rory Sutherland. Foreword. Challenging COCA-COLA. Imagine for a moment you're sitting in the boardroom of a major global drinks company, and your job is to produce a new product that will rival the position of Coke as the world's second most popular cold, non-alcoholic drink. That's after water. Well, what would you say? How would you respond? Well, the first thing I would say, unless I were in a particularly mischievous mood, is probably something like this. We need to produce a drink that tastes nicer than Coke, that costs less than Coke, and that comes in a really big bottle so people get great value for money. What I'm fairly sure nobody would say is this. Hey, why don't we try marketing a really expensive drink that comes in a tiny can and that tastes kind of disgusting? Yeah, that's exactly what one company did. And by doing so, they launched a soft drinks brand that would indeed go on to be a worthy rival to Coca-Cola. That drink was Red Bull. When I say Red Bull tastes kind of disgusting, this is not a subjective opinion. In fact, I drink quite a lot of it myself. No, that was the opinion of a wide cross-section of the public. Supposedly, before Red Bull launched outside Thailand, where it first originated, the licensee did approach a research agency to see what the international consumer reaction would be to the drink's taste. The agency, a specialist in researching the flavouring of carbonated beverages, had never before seen a worse reaction to any proposed new product. Normally, in consumer trials of new drinks, unenthusiastic respondents might phrase their dislike fairly diffidently. It's not really my thing. It's slightly cloying. It's more like a drink for kids. It's too sweet. That kind of thing. In the case of Red Bull, the criticism was almost verging on the angry. Supposedly, one person had said, "I wouldn't drink this piss if you paid me to." That was the kind of refrain. And yet no one can deny that the drink has been wildly successful. After all, profits from the 6 billion cans sold annually are sufficient to fund a Formula One team on the side, and a great deal else. The case for magic. There's a very simple premise to this book, that while the modern world often turns its back on this kind of illogic, sometimes it's uniquely powerful. Alongside the inarguably valuable products of science and logic, there are also hundreds of seemingly irrational solutions to human problems just waiting to be discovered, if only we're brave enough to abandon conventional logic in the search for answers. Unfortunately, because logic has proved so reliable in the physical sciences, we now believe it must be applicable everywhere, even in the much messier field of human affairs. The models that dominate all human decision-making today are heavy on logic and light on magic. A spreadsheet, after all, leaves no room for miracles. But what if this approach is sometimes wrong? What if in our quest to recreate the certainty of the laws of physics, we are now too eager to impose the same consistency and certainty in fields where it simply has no place? Let's take work and holidays, for example. Some 68% of Americans would pay to have 2 weeks more holiday than the meager 2 weeks most get at present. And by pay, I mean they'd accept a 4% pay cut in return for doubling their amount of vacation time. But what if there were no cost whatsoever to increasing everybody's vacation allowance? What if we discovered that greater leisure time would benefit the US economy, both in terms of money spent on leisure goods and also in greater productivity? Perhaps people with more vacation time might be prepared to work for longer in life rather than retiring to a Florida golf course as soon as it became affordable. Or perhaps they might simply be better at their jobs if they were reasonably rested and inspired by travel and leisure. Besides, it's now plausible that for many jobs, recent advances in technology mean there's little difference in the contribution you make to your workplace, whether you're in a cubicle in Boise, Idaho, or on a beach in Barbados. There's an abundance of supporting evidence for these magical outcomes. The French are astonishingly productive when they're not on holiday. The German economy is successful despite 6 weeks of annual leave being commonplace. But there's no model of the world that allows for America to contemplate, let alone trial, this possibly magical solution. In the left-brain logical model of the world, productivity is proportional to hours worked, and a doubling of holiday time must lead to a corresponding 4% fall in salary, along with a 4% fall in GDP. And so the technocratic mind models the economy as though it were a machine. If the machine is left idle for a greater amount of time, then it must be less valuable. But the economy is not a machine. It's a highly complex system. Machines don't allow for magic. complex systems do. And similarly, engineering doesn't allow for magic, but psychology does. In our addiction to logic, we've created a magic-free world of neat economic models, business case studies, and narrow technological ideas, which together give us a wonderfully reassuring sense of mastery over a complex world. Often these models are useful, but sometimes they're inaccurate or misleading, and occasionally they're highly dangerous. We should never forget that our need for logic and certainty brings costs as well as benefits. The need to appear scientific in our methodology may prevent us from considering other, less logical and more magical solutions, which might be cheap, fast-acting and effective. The mythical butterfly effect does actually exist, but we don't spend enough time butterfly hunting. Here's some recent butterfly effect discoveries simply from my own working experience. A website adds a single extra option to its checkout procedure and increases sales by $300 million a year. An airline changes the way in which flights are presented and sells £8 million worth more of premium seating every year. A software company makes a seemingly inconsequential change to call centre procedures and retains business worth several million pounds. A publisher adds four trivial words to a call centre script and doubles the rate of conversion to sales. A fast food outlet increases sales of a product by putting the price, wait for it, up. All these disproportionate successes were entirely illogical. No economist could have come up with them. And yet all of them worked. And all of them, apart from the first, were produced by a division of my advertising agency, Ogilvy, which I founded precisely to look for illogical solutions to problems. We discover that problems almost always have a plethora of illogical solutions waiting to be discovered, but that nobody's looking for them. Everybody's too preoccupied with logic to look anywhere else. We also found, rather annoyingly, that the success of this approach did not always guarantee repeat business. It's difficult for a company, or indeed a government, to request a budget for the pursuit of such magical solutions, because, back to logic again, your business case has to look logical. It's true that logic is the best way to succeed in an argument, but if you want to succeed in life, it's not necessarily all that useful. Entrepreneurs, I would argue, are disproportionately valuable, precisely because they're not confined to doing those things that make sense to a committee. Interestingly, the likes of Steve Jobs, James Dyson, Elon Musk, or Peter Thiel are often certifiably bonkers. Henry Ford famously despised accountants. The Ford Motor Company was never audited while Henry had control of it. When you demand logic, you pay a hidden price. You destroy magic. And the modern world, oversupplied as it is with economists, technocrats, managers, analysts, spreadsheet tweakers, and algorithm designers, is becoming a more and more difficult place to practice magic, or even to experiment with it. In what follows, I hope to remind everyone that magic should have a place in our lives, and indeed that it's never too late to discover your inner alchemist. Introduction. Cracking the Human Code. I'm writing this book with two screens in front of me, one of which is displaying a series of recent results from a test that my colleagues have just performed to try to increase the effectiveness of charity fundraising. Once a year, volunteers for our client charity drop printed envelopes through millions of doors and return a few weeks later to collect people's donations. This year, the envelopes contained a hurricane relief appeal. But some of these envelopes were randomly different from the rest. 100,000 of them announced that the envelopes had been delivered by hand by volunteers. A further 100,000 encouraged people to complete a form, which meant their donation would be boosted by a 25% tax rebate. 100,000 were in better quality envelopes, that's made out of better quality paper. And a final 100,000 were in portrait format, so that the flap of the envelope was placed along the short side rather than the long one. If you're an economist, you would look at the results of this experiment and immediately conclude that people are completely insane. Logically, the only one of these four changes that should affect whether people give is the one that reminds you that for every £1 you donate, the government will give a further 25p. The other three tests are seemingly irrelevant or inconsequential. Quality of the paper, the orientation of the envelope, or the fact that it was hand-delivered by a volunteer rather than, say, the postman, should add nothing to any rational reasons to donate. Wait for it. You see, the results tell a completely different story. The rational envelope, in fact, reduces donations by over 30% compared to the plain control, while the other three tests increase donations by over 10%. The higher quality paper also attracts a significantly higher number of more significant donations of £100 or above. Now, I know this all sounds really weird, but I hope that by the time you finish reading this book, you might better understand why these crazy-sounding results may make a strange kind of sense. Suffice to say that the human mind does not run on logic any more than the horse runs on petrol. What are the possible explanations for these results? Well, to be honest, I'm post-rationalizing or at least hypothesizing here, but maybe it feels more natural to put notes or checks in an envelope when the flap's on a shorter edge. Putting a check for £100 into a thick envelope feels more agreeable than putting a check for £100 into one that's made of cheap, almost tissue paper. And possibly a volunteer's effort of hand-delivering the envelope may prompt the natural human urge to reciprocate. We appreciate the effort they've made. Perhaps the mention of a 25% bonus on their donation reduces the amount that people feel they need to give. Stranger still, it also reduced the proportion of people who gave anything at all. I'll be honest with you, I have really no idea why this should be. But here's the thing. To a logical person, there would have been no point in testing three of these variables, but they are the three that actually work. This is an important metaphor for the contents of this book. If we allow the world to be run by logical people, we will only discover logical things. But in real life, most things aren't logical, they are psychological. There are two reasons behind people's behavior, the logical reason and the real reason. I've worked in advertising and marketing for the last 30 years. I tell people I do it to make money, to build brands, and to solve business problems, and none of these are things I really dislike. But to be absolutely truthful, I do it because I'm nosy. Modern consumerism is the best-funded social science experiment in the world. It's the Galapagos Islands of human weirdness. More important still, an ad agency is one of the few remaining safe spaces for weird or eccentric people in the world of business. In an ad agency, maverick opinion is still broadly encouraged, or at least tolerated. You can ask stupid questions or make silly suggestions and still get promoted. This is much more valuable than we realize, because to reach intelligent answers, you often need to ask really dumb questions. In most corporate settings, if you suddenly asked, "Why do people clean their teeth?" you'd be looked at as a lunatic, quite possibly unsafe. There is, after all, an official, approved, logical reason why we clean our teeth, to preserve dental health and reduce cavities or decay. Move on, nothing to see here. But as I'll explain later in this book, I don't think that's the real reason. For instance, if it is, why are 95% of all toothpastes flavoured with mint? Human behaviour is an enigma. Learn to crack the code. You see, my assertion is that large parts of human behaviour are like a cryptic crossword clue. There's always a plausible surface meaning, but there's also a deeper answer hidden beneath the surface. Five across. Does perhaps rush around. Four letters. Now, to someone who's unfamiliar with cryptic crosswords, it will seem almost insane that the correct answer to this clue is deer. Now, a simple crossword would have a clue like sylvan ruminants, four. But to a cryptic crossword aficionado, solving this clue is relatively simple, provided you accept that nothing is as it first appears. The surface of the clue has misled you to see does and rush as verbs, where both are actually nouns. You see, it isn't does at all. Does here is actually the plural of doe. Rush is a reed. Reed around, spelt backwards, is actually deer. Now, okay, this is not well suited to an audiobook as distinct from a book, but I'm just going to let you pause for a second. If you see D-O-E-S, 99 times out of 100, it refers to a verb, does, and your brain reads it like that. It seems the natural thing to do. Only 1% of the time is D-O-E-S going to really refer to the plural of the female deer. And similarly, rush, because it's actually followed by around, you have to assume is a verb too. But in cryptic crossword world, those usual rules don't apply. And this level of insight that's required to solve cryptic crosswords is only possible once you know not to take the clue literally. human behaviour is often cryptic in a similar sense. There's an ostensible, rational, self-declared reason why
we do. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.